There's another example, I think it's in the book, honey, about the AOL Time Warner merger, and that Dick Parsons, who's a now head of Time Warner, was asked why didn't he was against the merger, which was a disaster.
Yeah.
And they said, why didn't you tell Jerry that you were opposed to them? And Dick, who's a tough guy, and I was, he said, there are certain things you don't talk to Jerry about, to Jerry Levin about. So how do we, so the leader, it has to start there.
But in the book, there's a case too where I don't know whether it was you or James who went to an organization and they all sat around the table. And he said, why don't you tell me about the culture here and this? And nobody spoke up. But when they could write it anonymously, they would then open.
Yeah. And there are ways now of more and more ways of opening up organizations. Some people, you know, have regular meetings. There's a president of a large automobile company who actually meets with once a month with what he calls diagonal slices, that is people at different levels and cross the different parts of the, and to just talk in a fairly open way. Mort Meyerson, who used to run EDS under Perot, and he would have every month what he called intellectual fitness workouts, where people would share ideas about what's going on in the organization. It is hard, and one has to keep at it continually, but but given the top-down hierarchy, of, still today, of most organizations, that connection between the leader and even the people close, but the point, what I'm getting at is that some leaders have been able to achieve this. I think Mort Meyerson, to a certain extent, could achieve it. Ross Perot couldn't.
Yeah.
But I think it means creating structures.
Yeah.
Email these, I mean, special emails that the boss, Howard Schultz reads the blog of this is anonymous, in Starbucks. I mean, so I think leaders, unless they figure out ways to get information from all sources, see, let me give one more negative example, and this is George W. Bush on his first trip, returning from his first trip to the Middle East, tells the press that he was surprised at the amount of hostility toward the U.S. he discovered, and he was then interviewed by a friendly but in this case relentless reporter, Britt Hume on Fox News, a very friendly network. And said, Mr. President, I was surprised that you were surprised about this hostility. Where do you get your news from? And Bush said, straight-faced, I get my news from objective sources. And Humes quickly responded, well, who are your objective sources? And then Mr. Bush said, again with a straight face, my direct reports, the people who report to me. Now, you know, and I know, Connie, and the people viewing this show know, that you cannot just rely on that. It means looking everywhere, all those disruptive inflection points that are going on right. This world, I think, right now, as we're talking, I have a phrase which my students didn't get, but I think our audience will. I talked about, I think our globe is in a state of arrhythmia. I think we're in a very chaotic, spinning, almost out of control world of information right now. And this is why the opportunity to be here with you even helps me try to figure out why the powerful need for more and more of openness, which is time, I mean, it isn't just information. Information is a glut, but it's information with relevance, with meaning, and that's timely.
Yeah, and time to take it in, absorb it, and be able then to comprehend, because you can be told things, but if you don't comprehend the ramifications of it, then you're just, you know, you're getting thrown darts at.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And one of the things that, one of the big things lacking, Connie, in most organizations in this 24/7 world, this global world, is time for reflection. Now, interestingly enough, the Army, you mentioned Soldiers of Reason. I haven't read that book, but it sounds interesting. But The Army does do debriefing. The Army is reflective. And as a matter of fact, if you look at some of the records about what's happened in Iraq, since this is all stuff that General Eric Shinseki, mm-hmm. who, by the way, was relieved by Mr. Rumsfeld, because he was speaking truth to power.
He was saying you need more men on the ground.
He was saying it in 03, and he was just totally dismissed, eviscerated by Mr. Rumsfeld. And because he was speaking truth to power, there's the price of speaking truth to power. But why did we, if anything, we become somewhat more effective, if we become effective at all, who knows, in Iraq since the so-called surge? It's because Shinseki realized that you got to get information from the soldiers on the ground.
Yeah.
And that's because he said our training manuals are not up to date. He was saying things.
Yeah.
And by the way, from people on the Senate, I was wondering why General Shinseki even said what he said, because he's a very careful man. And he was almost forced to by Senator Schumer.
But you also say that Colin Powell could have changed things if he had been given the truth of the situation when he spoke up at the United Nations. You mentioned how Schultz from Starbucks.
Right.
He has taken a stand knowing that he's losing money with his company to cut 600 stores. Is that transparency? Is that doing it late? What is the sort of modus beyond?
You know, this is where some personal knowledge about Starbucks may be useful. I think Howard is probably one of the most transparent leaders I've met in corporate America.
Yeah.
I think he had to take action. I think he was transparent because he has been talking for almost the last 12 months about the truth of Starbucks is we've lost our soul.
Mm-hmm.
And we've got to bring back not just the aroma of good coffee, but we've got to bring back what we're all for, which is not the coffee, but the experience. That's the Starbucks line. And I think he's been as transparent based on my knowledge of him. And if there's time, I'll give you one example.
I wish I could. We're running out of time, unfortunately, Warren. Let's talk further another time because there's so much to discover in this book.
I've not been transparent enough. I need more
to
time.
To me, you are. Always honest and truthful. Will you sign my book?
I'd love to. Thanks, Colleen.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit us on the web at www.conniemartinson.com or email us at talksbooks@lycos. Support your library. And I'll tell you, there's another book that'll get you talking at the table. Martin Cohen's book, 101 Ethical Dilemmas. It's a great way to know what people in your family really think and have them express it, because you have to think before you can speak. And we'll see you next time. Thank you, Warren.
Well, thank you, Connie, again.